As you study vitamins, I recommend you organize your information so you can compare and contrast this. A chart such as this is helpful and has been included in your vitamin study questions. In this video, I'm going to go through three of them. We're going to take a look at thiamine, riboflavin, and niacin. These three have many similarities, so going through them in this way will provide you with an example of how to organize your information. Now, I've taken this chart and I've enlarged it, and so we're going to go in and just fill in each one of those boxes, starting with thiamine. Thiamine is B1, also known as B1, and it was labeled B1 because it was the first B vitamin discovered, and that was back in 1926. In the source box, I've provided here some information about the RDA and the average intake of these vitamins. You do not need to memorize these numbers. I provided it just out of interest to see how typical American diets meet these vitamins. And we can see for both males and females, the average intakes are more than the RDAs. Remember, it's not unhealthy to eat above RDAs. RDAs are set to prevent deficiencies for nearly all healthy individuals. What we can say is, from this data, is that on average, the U.S. diet meets or exceeds the needs for thiamine to prevent deficiencies. MyPlate places foods into food groups based upon their nutrient content, and this is how you should consider sources of vitamins. And that's what I'm going to expect you to identify in exams. For thiamine, we see the two groups are grains and protein foods. Grains provide about 60% of all the thiamine we consume each day, and then those protein foods provide another 20 to 25%. The remaining thiamine is coming in smaller amounts and other food groups. If we look at specific foods within this group, and we're going to look here at these charts, and the first chart, the first bar, is where we would look at thiamine. And we have for both whole grains and enriched grains, enriched refined grains have similar amounts of thiamine in its typical portion. So a typical portion of rice has about 10 to 15% of the daily value. And so that doesn't look like a significant amount until you think about that you have 6 to 10 servings of grains each day. So it's our primary source. I want to emphasize again that this is enriched. Enrichment means adding back nutrients after they have been pulled out through the refining process. And that enrichment process adds it back to about the level that was there before. If we look at the protein groups, we have two foods here with beans and pork. They're much more concentrated. Here, half a cup of bean has about 35% of the daily value, and 3 ounces of pork has about 70% of the daily values. So very much more concentrated in, but grains are our major source because of the number of servings we have. Coming back to our chart, we take a look at the function. We need thiamine to convert pyruvate to acetyl-CoA. We also need it to convert alcohol to acetyl-CoA. And anytime you use more of that pathway, you'll need more thiamine. So heavy alcohol consumers would need more thiamine. A deficiency then would relate directly to that. The deficiency disease is known as beriberi, and it's just a phrase that means I can't, I can't. And the problem gets to be is a drop in energy production. And that is there because we need this pathway here from pyruvate to acetyl-CoA for glucose energy metabolism. So without enough thiamine, we cannot go through that pathway. Another problem is neurological damage. And we can see that with this image again, the loss of muscle mass, because thiamine is needed for normal, healthy nerve functioning. If we think about where they have problems with that, and beriberi was a common in Asia before enrichment programs. So enrichment started in the 1940s. Before that, it was widespread, but since the 1940s, it has largely eliminated beriberi in developed countries. But it's still a problem in developing countries where polished rice is a staple food, but it's not enriched. If we think about too much, there are no known negative effects from consuming too much thiamine, and that includes taking high doses in supplements. Because of that, there has not been a UL set, an upper limit set, because there's no known negative effects. The next B vitamin that we'll look at is riboflavin. And once again, we can take a look at these average intakes and see that for both males and females, we are meeting or exceeding the amount that would be needed to prevent a riboflavin deficiencies. The food groups, similar in that they are the grains, but now it's going to be the dairy group. Grains provide about 40% of all the riboflavin we consume typically, and another additional 25 to 30% are coming from that dairy group. If we look at some examples of specific foods, and now we're going to look at the yellow bars. We can see once again here that it is both whole grains and refined, but these refined grains have been enriched. And they added back to about the same level, about 5% in a typical one slice of bread. But with that 6 to 10 servings per day, it is going to be a significant source. Milk then is going to be more concentrated. Here's a cup of milk, has 35% of the daily value, and yogurt has about 45%. One thing about riboflavin, that is destroyed by UV light. So UV light destroys riboflavin. So it's important, if you buy your milk in glass containers, that you don't let it sit on the counter. Make sure you get that put back in the refrigerator, because leaving it out on the counter and having UV light hit it will destroy that vitamin B2. Coming back to our chart, take a look at the functions. So the function here, that riboflavin, the F of the flavin, actually stands for that F there, and then adenine dinucleotide. And I'm just going to use the abbreviation here. FAD is a carrier of energized hydrogen. Through the electron transport chain. And that's a key part of energy metabolism. When we don't have enough riboflavin, the deficiency is titled ariboflavinosis, which just means no, the condition of no riboflavin. And once again, we have an inability for energy production. And then we have many problems with our mouth and the GI tract, the part of the mouth that we can see. The symptoms that are described are chelosis, which is just these angular fissures at the mouth, and glossitis. Glossitis just means inflammation of the tongue, so we have a red, beefy tongue. It seems that riboflavin is not common, a deficiency by itself, because if you don't have enough riboflavin in your diet, you typically don't have enough thiamine and niacin, and other deficiencies are there. But there have been instances of just having riboflavin deficiency. A toxicity, similar to niacin. There were no negative effects, and there have been no UL set because of that. These are water-soluble vitamins, so when you take them in higher doses, they usually are just urinated out. The last B vitamin then is B3, and we once again can compare our average intakes for both males and females, and well above, so that we're meeting or exceeding the needs of niacin to prevent deficiencies. The food groups are grains. And we're back to those protein foods. Grains provide about 40 to 45% of all the niacin we consume each day, and so do those protein foods. So these are our two major sources of niacin. If we look at specific foods, we're now going to look at the red graph, bar graphs. And once again, with both whole and refined, but those refined are enriched. And we're adding them back to about the same levels, about 10% of the daily value in one serving. We see here that with these protein foods, here's chicken, here's pork, 105, 62% of the daily value, so much more concentrated. Meat tends to be very concentrated in niacin for two reasons. It contains niacin, but also we have an essential amino acid called tryptophan, and this has been shown to be able to convert to niacin. So for that reason, protein foods are a special source of niacin. Coming back to our charts, we can look at the function of niacin. It's going to be similar to FAD, except for a different molecule. Now we have niacin, nicotinamide, adenosine dinucleotide. And once again, it's going to be a carrier of those energized hydrogen through the electron transport chain. It even seems that the NAD is more important for this function than FAD because the deficiency symptoms is much more severe. A deficiency of niacin is labeled pellagra, which just means dry or rough skin, and that's the part of the niacin deficiency that we can see. Niacin deficiency is known as the 4Ds, the symptoms. We have dermatitis. We can see in this image. We would see it in the extremities as well, anywhere around the body, especially if it has sun being exposed. And it also has, if we progress with the deficiency, we develop diarrhea, dementia, mental disorder, and then finally death. In the United States, this was a real problem before the enrichment programs began in 1940. Between 1907 and 1940, there were probably 3 million cases of pellagra in the United States and 100,000 deaths. So it was a real problem until we added it back to our refined flours. When we think about too much, there's no negative effects when it comes to high doses from food, so you don't need to worry about taking too much from that. But we do have some issues when we take larger amounts of niacin in supplementals. We have a positive impact in that when you take a supplemental form of niacin, it will help lower LDL and raise HDLs, and those are associated with improvement of your risk for cardiovascular disease. But we have some negative effects. Long term, we can have liver damage. And on a short term, we can have something known as niacin flush. And here's an image of it, where you take a fairly concentrated amount of niacin. In about 15, 30 minutes after you take it, you have this dilation of your blood and your nerves, and you get this tingling and flushed feeling. It lasts for about 1 to 2 hours. There's no long-term negative effects, but it's something usually people don't want to do twice. Still, we do have a long-term negative effects of liver damage, so it's important if you do take a niacin supplement that you're under physician care. The UL for this has been set at 35 milligrams, which if we compare that to these intakes, you can see we're close. But these intakes are for food intakes, and that UL is for supplemental forms. So here we've collected information for 3 B vitamins. It's a way to go through and collect your information so you can easily compare and contrast them.